I think my mic's on now.
You think so?
Ouch.
If you leave the room, make sure you re-mic it. Is this good? Are you mic'd? I don't know. Talk to the producer. Is that... Now you're screwing me up. Okay, so welcome back to the hilarity that is 417. Producer, can you verify that both of our mics are on? We're good? We're good? Okay, thank you. We got the thumbs up sign. To the audience that's in the room, which is the producer, they can hear us. The online people can't hear us. We're coming back from the last module talking about Hyper-V, and now we're talking about Hyper-V in a clustered environment and a highly available environment. So really cool stuff. I need to get my other producer to make sure that I've got my timer on correctly.
I got your timer on here.
Because the timer's on your other machine?
Timer.
Good, good.
We're going to go for an hour.
The reason why I'm saying I need the timer on is because I could literally talk about Hyper-V, high availability of Hyper-V, and all the nuances around virtualization and that sort of stuff for hours. And so I'm trying to respect...
As we saw in the last module.
I'm trying to respect the attendees' time to make it so that we're keeping this tight and focused, which is a hard thing for us today for some reason. Focus is lacking right now. This module, this module is all about how to implement failover clustering with Hyper-V. Now, because as we saw in the last module with Hyper-V, you can now use SMB as one of your storage locations as opposed to using a cluster. It opens up a new realm of possibilities for high availability, so we'll touch on that at the end. And I'm also going to talk about some cool stuff for disaster recovery with Replica Broker and how that works. So neat, neat stuff that's in there for the next ones coming up. So again, this is module 9 of a 12-module course that we're looking at right now, and this one specifically for working with failover clustering with Hyper-V, and so far so good. We're on track and ready to go, my friend. So first off, clustering, what does it do? It gives you the ability to have a service or workloads available in a highly available fashion, so it only makes sense that you would make it so that you could have a Hyper-V workload available in a highly available fashion, obviously. So yes, we'll talk about how to set that up. How to implement Hyper-V virtual machines on failover clusters. It's slightly different if you haven't worked them before. Like if you're used to working just with a Hyper-V manager to make your machines on a single box and work with it on a single box, then you know that's one way of working with them. You actually have some slight nuances or changes you have to worry about when you're using a failover cluster for how to be able to make these guys work. How to have some level of movement with your Hyper-V machines, where we talk about the old way of moving machines, the new way of moving machines, and the really cool new way of moving machines and storage all around between your different systems. Very, very cool stuff. I'll be able to show you the stuff related to the clustering side of things because of our current setup of the hardware that we have. And finally, how you're going to be able to go off and manage your systems. So what are your choices for making your workload of a virtual machine highly available? It comes down to really three things, and honestly, we're only going to be covering one of those three things in this entire session, which is the first one, host clustering, because that's where the physical hosts in a multi-node cluster are looking after those workloads for Hyper-V. Guest clustering is where your virtual machine guests are the ones that are using the cluster node and the clustering technology. That's the one that you can do yourself on a single individual lab system environment, or even in a production environment if you wanted to, where all the guest clustering components or all the clustering components are all installed on the VMs themselves. So, for instance, your iSCSI target would be a VM running the iSCSI target service, running server 2012. Your iSCSI initiators are your two boxes. They are running as guests on server 2012, and they are going to initiate and talk to that iSCSI target. You then are able to establish a cluster. You obviously can't put Hyper-V inside a Hyper-V to be able to run it.
Why not?
But you can at least make a cluster inside that virtualized environment with no hardware whatsoever, all in a single box if you want to play around with it to be able to do it. Basically using iSCSI or the new fiber channel pass-through if you wanted to. And NLB, or network load balancing, which is also an option basically for web workloads to be able to have multiple web farms up and running to be able to service those requests that come in. We're not going to be talking about NLB and not going to be talking about guest clustering because we're going to focus on the main one, which is host clustering.
Just picturing that Hyper-V instead of Hyper-V is kind of like when you take a video camera and you point it at the monitor.
Or the mirror, and you just get that. What was that movie about waking up and dreaming and dreaming about dreaming and dreaming? Inception, was that it, or something like that? Is that kind of the same thing?
I think you lived that. I don't think there was a.
Could be. Failover clusters.
Oh, when the guy's on the train. I know what you're talking about.
Yeah. Well, that's a different movie where the guys. We're not going to talk about
movies. Listen, you got limited time here.
Node 1 and Node 2, basically, once again, they've got this cluster in the back end. As far as cluster storage, they've got dedicated bus of network transport to be able to get access to that particular storage area. And basically, Hyper-V is going to be running on those individual nodes. That clustered storage is going to be known as a clustered shared volume, or CSV, specifically set up as part of the failover cluster manager to be able to make it so that the both nodes can actively have access to that one piece of storage, and then can then go and share the processes. They can move the processes that are the actual workloads back and forth amongst themselves as required between the different systems. The idea as well is that you also happen to have a dedicated network that is where you're going to be having your heartbeats going back and forth between your different nodes. The default heartbeats going through basically at a second or 1,000 milliseconds. If it by default surpasses 5 seconds, which is 5,000 milliseconds, it's going to basically be in a drop state and basically have to go in and transfer that workload over to node number 2. And there goes the machine. It's all happy, restarts on the other side, and you're all good to go. This is an unplanned failover when that happens. Once that other box is back up again, you can do a controlled migration back to that other side when that node happens to be back up and running again. So, simple sort of stuff. Here's another errata that I found that is interesting. Again, this courseware and the virtual machine demos that we're showing you are actually based on the release candidate because of the timing when this mock courseware was actually created. At the time, we were only publicly speaking about a supported 4,000 virtual guests inside a 64-node cluster. We've now upped that and will officially support, as of the release to manufacturing and the launch, we did our big announcement of 8,000 virtual machines per cluster of 64 nodes that's up there. So big support for a number of the virtual machines that are increased. Now, I don't know how this translates to an exam environment, and we're not talking specifically about exams, but is the exam based on the RTM or based on the code that it was written on, Mr. MCT?
Yes. No, that is the answer, and that has been the answer, and that is a typical question that I get at all times. Same question comes out anytime a service pack comes out. Same mm-hmm. question comes up every time R2 comes out.
My philosophy has always been is you have to take it from the perspective of when the exam was written and find out.
Always know the latest stuff.
Yeah, it's always know the latest stuff, yeah. But however, there is a revision cycle and a lag that happens between when the latest stuff comes out and when the exams get revised as well. And
here's what I can tell you my experience has been. When you're going to get down to a bullet point like that that talks about 4,000 versus 8,000,
it's probably not going to come up.
You're usually not going to get something that is that specific to where you're going to be fooled based upon RC and RTM. Microsoft Learning is aware that
numbers
change. That happens, and so therefore they make sure to word a question. They want to know that you know how to implement the technology. You want to know what the technology is.
Okay.
You're not going to have to know 4,000 versus 8,000.
Okay, good.
Now, that said, everybody send me, you know, everyone just pound on me when you get that question on 4,000 versus 8,000.
He got it. His Twitter handle is @trainsignal_ed.
Good thing I don't use Twitter.
You got it. Send him an email. Oh, his email's not up there. Darn it.
No. Facebook train signal.
You got it. You can obviously go off with failover clustering and go off and select multiple virtual machines for live migration. In the past, you basically did it sequentially. One machine would do the live migration, finish, and the next machine would do the live migration, finish, the next machine would do the live migration, and finish. Now, basically, it goes in batches and can handle multiple VMs at the same time. You're basically limited by your hardware throughput to be able to do it. You also have the ability to set a priority for the machines during boot up and restarting so that they know these guys come up first, these guys come up later, mm-hmm. with the delay process that's in there. Cluster shared volumes have some improvements from a scalability perspective, dynamically reclaiming space perspective, and also the ability to now support bit lockering of those volumes for an added security layer, which is quite good. You can now have more insight into what's actually going on inside the machines with app monitoring. And then finally, you obviously want to be able to have the option to not exclusively just use cluster technology. You also can now use the highly available SMB file share and that sort of stuff, how that works.
I just like how you turned BitLocker into a verb.
BitLockered? What do you mean?
BitLockering.
BitLockering. I guess that's true.
We are BitLockering.
The best practices for implementing Hyper-V on a virtualized environment, basically. Server 2012 is a Hyper-V host. There's some questions about, can you do upgrades? What's the upgrade process? They're being handled inside the Q&A area, but yes, you obviously can go in and start to worry about your upgrade process from Server 2002 up to Server 2012 for Hyper-V. You're going to want to plan for your failover scenarios, and this is something that can tend to be overlooked by someone that's not familiar with clustering, where they'll spec out the hardware for a large number of systems to be running, and they'll stage it so that they have the appropriate resources spread across the load and everything's being nicely used from a resource perspective. But then when a failover occurs of one or more nodes, that workload that's on those servers has to move to one of the other guys. And that other guy it's moving to has to have the headroom to be able to support them. Otherwise, you can end up with problems, right? And machines won't be able to start. So obviously, you got to build for failure and make sure that you have the ability to handle the resources on the load of the servers when a failover happens to occur. So plan for failovers, test those failures, make sure they're all good. Same thing with storage overall for overall size and location of storage. We already talked about deploying standardized Hyper-V host and standard management practices. So I'm actually going to drop out here and go to a little bit of a demo in just a moment here where I'm going to show you the Hyper-V cluster manager. Show you a little bit about this little cluster I'm using in the back end to maybe be able to make this work. So as I switch off and over here to this guy to see where he's at. There we go. So take a look at this demo machine here for a sec. We've got, in this case, I am looking at the failover cluster manager, and I've got my cluster that was created here. It's called MSTE-CLU. That was created. It's up and running. I do have, again, some warnings and errors, which are all related simply to network configuration, nothing fancy. And then we have, in this case, two individual nodes, node one, node number two. They're all running and happy just fine. There's actually no workloads on node number two. It's all still good. Now, we talked about migration of workloads and migrations of systems. If I just grab these guys over here, select multiple, and I say move with a live migration to select the node, I can move them all over to number two. And you can see that obviously it's going to migrate the harder ones, which are the ones that are currently running, and everything else will migrate over to node number two. And if I take a look as that copy process is taking place, this is basically checking the memory pages that are running, seeing that there's not been any changes, recreating the machine configuration on the other side of the other node, making sure the drives are in sync, and at the last possible moment, it does the last delta of the memory pages and goes. This does it all within what's known as the TCP window. Which is basically a ping. It happens within a ping to be able to work. They're all now basically up and running and good to go on the other side. I only have two that are basically up and going on the other side. The other guys were not even running or active, so they didn't need to be live migrated. They can be just moved. And they're now continuing to run. Everything's good. Nothing went down with those guys. They're all happy. They're all fine. And those guys there are sitting there. Interesting. I never realized. You can't do a live migrate of machines turned off.
Well, it wouldn't be live then.
I can do a move of it.
That'd be a dead migration?
Yeah, I guess it's a dead migration. I can do a storage migration, which is also new. But I've got those guys up and going. They're all happy. Workload perspective. Now, from a roles perspective as well, looking back at the entire list, you can now see that these guys are running on node number two. These guys are still on node number one. If I wanted to go off and to make a new machine with Hyper-V Cluster Manager, similar to what you would do with a regular environment, I'm going to say new virtual machine. I'm going to say target this guy on node number two just for the heck of it because he's got some resources available to him. The wizard pops up that you've seen before. It gives me the name request. This is Rick's demo machine. I'm going to store this in a different location, and this is where it's important to have that cluster shared volume reference because I'd need to know the LUN and the drive volume has been mapped to that individual LUN if I want to use a fiber channel SAN as an example. Instead, because I'm using cluster shared volumes, I know that I simply need to go down and browse to my C drive. Of course, I just want to go back down here to my C drive. There it is. Under clustered storage, volume number one, and I happen to have a directory structure called VMs that I'm throwing them in right now. Select that folder. This is going to be the same reference on every single node of my cluster that's using the cluster shared volumes, so it's easy for me to be able to find it. I'm going to say use dynamic memory for this virtual machine, start off with 512, finish off with a network that he's connected to, so his networking connectivity. Here is the location of the name of the file, location where that drive happens to be. Again, this is that cluster shared volume that I created earlier. I'm just going to say, don't bother installing the operating system right now. Go ahead and make that machine, configure them. Boom, off he is there and done. This guy is now made as a highly available resource and was now successfully set up. I can live migrate them, move them, and do anything I want to with that individual box, all because of Cluster Manager. If I made a machine outside of Cluster Manager and I made it with the regular hypervisor or I made it with PowerShell and it wasn't cluster aware because the commands that I was using and I didn't store it in the right location, a neat thing you can do is you can actually do an export and import, if you will, of that system. So if I configure my role, instead of doing a virtual machine, new machine, I can actually say configure the role and then choose the role of a Hyper-V workload, virtual machine. And then it actually will scan all the nodes that are running right now that are part of my cluster and then choose which machine I can basically make available to this environment. I'm going to say test VM, bring it in, and bring it up to the individual system and now make it available to my environment. It's going to say next, bring it over, bring them up, and it was successful and done. I basically did a very quick export and import on that new location to get that guy brought into as a highly available workload. There he is right there, my test VM, very simple sort of stuff. Another thing that can come up, which is rather interesting with regards to working with this environment, is if I take a look at my Hyper-V manager for this one guy that I said, non-HAVM, I'm just going to go ahead and simply say, shut this guy down. I'm going to look at the settings on him just to see where I stored his location of files, because I forget where I put it. Hard drive currently is on D drive, non-HAVMs. There we go. So he's now there. I'm able to go in, and this also will show off the importing capabilities. If I choose my D drive, VMs, there's my non-HA machine. I'm not doing an export. I'm just literally doing a copy of this, or a cut. It would be a better thing, I should guess I should do. And then I move them to my C drive, clustered storage, volume 1, and then drop them there. That's going to go ahead and take a little bit of time as it copies over 8 gigabytes worth of data on that system. While that guy's copying, when he is now inside the proper location of the clustered shared volume between those two Hyper-V nodes that are clustered, I can then do an import and then simply point to him as my new import location and then bring him inside my environment, which would then turn him into a highly available system too. So a couple of different ways to make a machine highly available natively through a wizard interface from the cluster manager, simply going in and doing an import from the existing machines that are already registered, or even doing an import from looking at the local drive to be able to bring it up. So yeah, simple sort of stuff to get him all up and happy. As long as he's in the right spot, you've got access to those different systems. Back in the cluster manager, you got something to
add? Well, I was just going to, you know, before we get too far, just real quick, you know, a couple things. One, you know, just to give everyone a break from this for just a second, I thought I should point it out because, just for your sake, it is Inception and Source Code is the other movie. But more importantly, a lot of people have been asking about, the heft just doesn't work as good.
Nice.
I didn't have good redundancy. So there's a lot of questions that are coming through because you did bring up about as far as testing. I just want to point out that later on today, at the end of the day, we are going to actually address a little bit about the testing and some of what you can do to help make sure that you can take this information and be prepared for the test.
Oh, you mean the bonus, the bonus section.
Yes, so the bonus section.
The unpublished
is that better?
Bonus
there
section.
We go.
There we go.
So I just want to let everyone know so we don't have to you know be flagging a lot of questions about that. And we're going to point to you to some locations where you can get those types of answers. All right, back to the awesome clustering demo.
You got it, man. I'm actually going to switch back the slides for just a little bit just
to
give you guys some
more
context. Cluster nodes, obviously, for Hyper-V clusters, they have to be physical machines because you can't do Hyper-V within Hyper-V. You're going to have to basically identify...
Because that would be Inception.
That would be Inception.
Okay.
You would then want to go off and basically identify which are my networks being used specifically to support my clustered shared volume shared storage, which is going to be set up for my virtual networks across my systems, making sure I have enough storage available and the type of storage available, and finally making my virtual machines highly available on my systems. So hardware requirements, basically, make sure you've got your server and hardware storage up and running, make sure you have your redundant network adapters and storage adapters in place. Software requirements are set up in such a fact that you have to have either standard or data center. Again, there's no difference between the functional capabilities between those two different systems. And I also added in, or the Hyper-V Server 2012 instance as well can be used to be able to set this up. You should have the same updates and service packs installed in the system, and you either need to be all full or all core installs. You don't want to be mixing and matching those individual requirements that are there. And then finally, you're going to want to make sure that you have all the proper addressing set up. You know which cables are plugged into which switches. You've got multiple paths if possible. You need to also have DNS up and running and domain running, because if you forgot from the very first section talking about clustering, we use Active Directory as an authentication mechanism between the different clusters to be able to identify, are they allowed to be part of the cluster and can I manage them easily? And you have to have the ability to administer the cluster, local admin rights on those cluster boxes to be able to set that up. Physically setting up the systems was the same as the setting up a cluster within the guests, which I showed you in the first module today that we looked at, which was module 7. Mm-hmm. So that was basically the same process of installing the feature of clustering, making sure that you have shared disk between the systems, and then going in to choose, configure the cluster, and you simply add in the different nodes. To be able to get that guy up and happy and working. And then after it's created, you can tweak the type of quorum that you want to use. It takes a default quorum that goes up there.
Now, one thing real quick, Rick. You said that you added in the Hyper-V version. There's a number of questions that have been coming through as far as what you can and can't do specifically with that version. I know you've already pointed out that that nodes, you know, or virtual machines from that version can be clustered. Mm-hmm. Can you do all of this strictly from Windows Server 2012 Hyper-V?
Yeah.
Do you know?
Yes, I do know. Hyper-V Server 2012, as I'll state again, has a limitation where the only role that it can do is Hyper-V. It can only virtualize. That's what you're licensed to use, and that's what you're able to do on that individual box. It is able to be domain joined, and because it is able to be domain joined, and because it is essentially the same capabilities of no hardware restrictions and no other limitations placed on it from a resource perspective, has the same capabilities to be a cluster, be part of a 60-node cluster. You can have a 64-node cluster just of Hyper-V Server 2012 if you wanted to. The difference is that there are no guest operating system licenses mm-hmm. on that box whatsoever. You have to basically procure your own licenses for it. And for the guests, that is. Mm-hmm. You manage it remotely using the tool, which is Server Manager, to be able to manage it remotely. Once you've got S-configged in there to be able to make it part of the same network and make it all happy. There is third-party software out there that will allow you to go in and manage it with a interface. Basically, it's like a web app that runs on the individual box. Five9 software, I think, makes one. It's actually quite good. I've used that in the past. Someone was asking how you can manage it with a standalone workgroup environment with a Windows 8 machine. There's a lot of little fun things you have to do to make it work in a workgroup environment to be remotely managed, but it is possible as well. Some good blog articles out there on how to do that. And essentially, it's a viable option. However, it's not designed primarily for most enterprise customers that are going to be working, because they're going to be licensing and using standard and data center editions that are out there. Back to slides for implementing Hyper-V virtual machines on a failover cluster. You install it, you configure shared storage, you install Hyper-V in the failover clustering, you validate the cluster. So those are all the exact same steps you saw earlier. You create the cluster as well, same steps. You then go in and you basically create a virtual machine on one of the cluster nodes, like I just showed you how to make one. By saying new role, and then adding in the virtual machine as the role, and then that becomes the location for how to make the virtual machines highly available. The setup is great for the setup that we have working right now to get this guy up and happy. The one thing I haven't talked about just yet is the configuring of the cluster shared volumes. Literally, it's something that you simply have to turn on inside the cluster manager, so the cluster failover manager. The CSV, you then identify which of your storage disks will be used for the CSV. Once you've done that, basically you'll be referring to that clustered shared volume always as the location of C:\clustered storage/volume1, or whatever the volume happens to be. And it'll be the same for all of the nodes of your cluster. We'll refer that to the exact same location. It's more efficient use of disk space because you're not LUN restricted. And there is no special hardware required to be able to go off and have that guy running. And basically, to implement it, you create and format the volume on shared storage. You add the disks into your failover cluster. It has to have networking connectivity, obviously. So it's going to be iSCSI attached, or it's going to be shared SAS, or it's going to be Fibre Channel. And then finally, you add the storage into the CSV itself. So I believe we've got a good question you wanted to bring up there, bud.
Yes, there is a question. And everything's like scrolling through here.
Now it says green hat.
It says green hat. This is great. Where did the question go? It was a question about, can you please explain shared nothing? So many people have tried to explain it, but they fall over. I wanted to see if that was maybe fail over. They fall over every time.
Shared
nothing.
Are
you going to fall over?
Shared nothing migration.
Shared nothing, in quotes, shared nothing.
Yes, so shared nothing live migration is, I believe actually I talk about, let me just see here quickly. You know what, I'm going to get to it in just a couple of seconds, but essentially, as long as you have two Hyper-V systems on the same network, in the network, not even the same network, in the network, they are part of the same domain. They're running Hyper-V server 2012. So they're running Hyper-V role on server 2012, and they have networking connectivity, and you have administrative access on those boxes. You can take a workload or a virtual machine in a non-clustered environment. Planned failovers when you'd be using this. Right mouse click on that server and say move, and then you choose the destination. You have to enable this on both boxes. You have to set up some level of delegation called constrained delegation inside Active Directory to be able to do it. And you simply say move, and then it's going to go off and start to do copying of the data from one location to the other location while the machine's running. It's going to basically get that in sync with everything's happy. It's going to be able to recreate the computer configuration information from that one VM to the new VM that's being created on the new side of things. It's going to then start to synchronize the memory pages, get the memory pages all in sync. When it's all set and ready to go, the slowest part of this is the data copy of the 18 gigs of system files that are on that guy. Once it arrives on that second side of the machine and there's that cutover time period where we're basically almost identical across the board, it does that switch over to be able to do it. You can literally do a live migration with shared nothing live migration with nothing but an Ethernet cable connecting your different servers. And Jeff Woolsey has a great conversation going on where he's gone in and had multiple Hyper-V boxes on different floors of particular buildings here at Microsoft, and he's able to simply say live migrate upstairs, live migrate across the hall, live migrate to building 20, live migrate back to building 43. And it's just a matter of waiting for this copy process to finish, and it just goes. It literally is like the Holy Grail. There is no cluster required to be able to do it. Now, obviously, these machines are not highly available. If the machine that is now done and running that instance goes down, that machine is dead. The VM guest is dead. But as far as being able to have the mobility to move it from machine to machine anywhere using any networking connectivity, it's totally possible to do from a planned failover perspective. That's new with Server 2012. The requirements are simply have Server 2012 as your base hypervisor, have the role of Hyper-V installed, and then have common networking connectivity, have constrained delegation. Constrained delegation can be a little bit scary. I can't show you how to set this up with my environment right now, but I can show you at least what I'm talking about when I'm saying constrained delegation.
But while you're looking that up, I will say, you know, Martin, who asked the question, has already responded with perfect thank you.
Okay, good.
What I want to know from Martin is, was the one-line answer that Simon gave you
better,
the perfect thank you, or the 5 minutes that Rick just gave you the perfect thank you?
Nice. I can feel the love in this room, let me tell you. What was I trying to show you again? Oh, yeah. I want to show you this is the one thing, it's the hiccup that some people don't quite get. Again, I'm doing this in my virtualized environment. You would normally be doing this on the actual live Active Directory outside of your Hyper-V guys. Basically, if I had two hosts machines that are my physical install of Hyper-V that are not clustered, I would simply have to go in here, go and choose properties, choose delegation, and then say trust this computer for delegation of any service, or I can choose a specific service, in which case I need to go in and choose the service type and then the what's involved. I just choose this from a demo perspective to say any service that's available, hit apply, and then we're good. The other guy as well, have to enable him as well for constrained delegation. Turn that guy on, Hit apply and OK. He's now done. And then from the Hyper-V boxes themselves, that guy's set up. From the Hyper-V boxes themselves, if I look at my Hyper-V controller here, there we go. Under Hyper-V settings, I have to simply say, is this guy supporting live migrations or not? And then what type of authentication am I going to be using to be able to get there? So that is good. So that's shared authentication migration.
All right.
And that's also one of those things that, again, it's some people see it more as an add-on to live migration, because previously in 2008 R2, live migration was only possible if you had that cluster shared volume. Mm-hmm. Shared nothing live migration is essentially similar technology for synchronizing the contents back and forth, but there's no shared drive storage that's being used. It literally is two different locations to be able to do it. The thing I like about that is also coming back here to my slides for just 1 second when I get there. F5 to do it. You can have your systems up and running and have your storage basically move around while leaving the virtual machines and their configurations running on the individual Hyper-V hosts. And so, for instance, you can do a storage migration, which is, again, getting the content of the local machine, VHD files and config files, stuff like that, copied over to the new location, brought in synchronization, and then cut over when it's in stasis, if you will, while the system's up and running. You could do a storage migration to an SMB file share, that's version 3 on server 2012, if you wanted to. You also are able to go in and to move from a local C drive location or D drive location of virtual machines with storage migration up to a shared network or into a SMB file share or into cluster shared volumes location as well. So you're given lots of flexibility for where and how you're going to be moving stuff in and stuff out. One thing I'll note about this guy here is that you can set this up with highly available virtual machines on SMB 3.0 file shares. You can make that SMB 3 file share highly available and then have individual hosts that are running and talking to that share, to that highly available SMB file share, and you can do shared nothing migration between them. Or you can set that up as Hyper-V workload in a cluster that is using the SMB file share for its storage location, not cluster shared volumes, but the SMB file share for location as well, to get extra layers of redundancy that's in there, which is very, very cool. Some considerations for Hyper-V clusters, simply what apps are going to be requiring high availability inside your VMs, are they going to be able to work inside that environment, what type of application characteristics are there, and basically verify your design is going to work for you, identify your dedicated network adapters for private virtual networks. Ideally, you're going to want to have, again, a dedicated network for your storage, maybe multipath for better performance and more redundancy. You're going to have a dedicated fast network between your systems if you're going to be using the two nodes of your cluster for moving those workloads back and forth. One potentially dedicated for management, and then also one for your clients to have access to as well. So you can get quite elaborate with your setups that you're using. So here is the actual slide about the virtual machine migration options. I don't know of too many people that would still be using quick migration. Quick migration basically is where you go in and you stop the virtual machine or you pause it basically. You move it over, then you make it reanimated again and rehydrated again. That was the old way of doing stuff for 2008. We don't use that technology as the primary ways of doing stuff now. Live migration is what I talked about already, using clustered shared volumes as the back end between Hyper-V nodes. Shared nothing live migration, which does not appear on this slide, is the one I went through at great detail because someone asked me the question, where you literally have just a network cable between them. In theory, although not supported, I've heard a Microsoft guy, Ben Armstrong, I don't know if you know him, virtualization guy, PC guy, he actually did a live, shared nothing live migration.
You're asking me or are you asking them?
I'm asking both.
Yeah.
he actually did a shared nothing live migration over a wireless network. Not supported, because just not supported, but he did it over a wireless network.
Not supported, but fun.
You got it. Then you got also the other option of Hyper-V replica, and then simple importing, exporting virtual machines. Replica is the one thing I haven't talked about just yet because it's coming up in my system. So storage migration is the underpinning of how shared nothing live migration works. During the migration, the virtual machine and the hard drive is basically copied from one location to the other. Changes are written to both from that point forward. The deltas are brought into sync so that you have very little left. You simply move the virtual machine storage to the same host, to another host, or to a different location. The storage and the virtual machine configuration can be in different locations if you wanted to. And at the very last moment, just like you would do a memory sync, the drives are in sync, boom, it cuts over, and you're good to go from a storage migration perspective. An animated slide for live migration. I think I covered this one here in great detail for where this guy goes for the animation, copies the files over, the smart paging files, the configuration files, gets them all in sync through the side.
Did you do that all by yourself?
I did that all by myself, man. And then simply the cutover happens. It's not very terribly exciting. A replica is my, I think, my last major point I want to cover, which is absolutely awesome. Inbox doesn't cost you a dime for what you can do with Hyper-V replica. Picture yourself where you know impending doom is arriving, let's say, and you need to get your content of your data center out of the location where it is right now, someplace else. You would, in the past, have to go through and literally, very expensive, do some kind of a replication of the SAN data centers between your different networks that are outside that location to do something, to get that all up and running. You'd have to have some kind of agreement to be able to do imports and exports on a regular basis. Now you simply enable the Hyper-V replica. You have to turn that on under settings for the local machine. Once it's turned on, you say, yes, I'm enabling Hyper-V replica. You then identify the destination for where you're going. And the really cool thing about this is the fact you can actually identify a non-domain joined, even non-physical same site, only network connectivity, like to a hosting provider, as an example, location, where the destination is going to be. You identify and you use a certificate-based authentication to that remote location to make sure it's secure, and you initiate a replica between those two different systems. When you finish off the wizard, what it basically does is it sends a copy of the configuration file traffic over to the other side. It then also starts a replication or a synchronization process between the running VM and that destination side. And then what that basically means is that this now is now going to replicate on a per machine basis across this WAN link to that destination, which could be a workgroup machine, could be a hoster machine, or could be another machine on your network if you wanted to. It basically tracks all the changes that go on that machine that's live and then brings it across to the replica site. If you're doing this to a cluster as either the outbound location or the inbound location, because there are multiple nodes that are your Hyper-V managers that are in that cluster, you basically have to add in a cluster role called the Hyper-V replica broker role. And that simply says, I am the main contact point that will be used for all inbound and outbound replications. And you initiate the synchronization. Now, if you do this, make sure that you're aware that this is not a live migration. This is a copy of the data file across the WAN link, or you can even seed it to basically do an export and import on the other side to save yourself some time. And then it's a synchronization from that point forward whenever it's done. You configure the intervals that things are synchronized. You then are able to go in and say, do a failover, and fail this guy over to the other side. It finishes up the last bit of replication over to the side and then tells that guy to basically start up. That guy can now start, and he's good to go. You can then also do a replica back to that first guy if you wanted to. And then when you need to, you can actually bring that guy back in again. Now, the machine is basically, quote-unquote, down while you're doing that move and the final synchronization from one side to the other side, but it's gotten you as a free, cost-effective way of getting replicas to the other side, outside of your data center, out to the other environment. So replica is new, only part of Server 2012, have to be Server 2012 hypervisor roles installed on your servers to be able to support this, but really way cool technology to be able to cover your butt in case it's a problem. Any good questions? Any good comments? Want to share anything?
Well, I will tell you that you know, you're gonna have to thank Martin, because now you pretty much have a good like 20 questions on the same topic. So.
Okay, great, man.
I'm actually in the middle of answering some certification questions. Actually,
certification.
Sure, certification.
Okay,
I learned that junior year in high school.
You got it.
It was the certification.
Back to the slides for one quick little second here for the actual configuration of the Hyper-V replica. Now, I can't show you this because the demo environments that we have, basically I've got two non-domain joined machines, one of which is currently down because Ed forgot to bring his power supply.
It's on!
It wasn't on in time for me to be able to prep the demo in the short time we had between these sessions.
Let's just make this clear. The only reason I'm here is to be your scapegoat.
Nice.
Two nonstop days of it.
And I can't show you the Hyper-V configuration of the Hyper-V replica because it actually has to contact the destination to make sure it's valid and working before I finish off the configuration options. Basically, you configure the authentication mechanisms, the certificate you're going to be using, the secure path you're going to be using with port 443 to do this replica traffic over it. You configure the firewall ports to allow for the replication to take place between those two different systems. You then identify who is the replica server, and then you right mouse click on the individual workload of the machine that you want to go off and move. This can be on a single standalone non-clustered environment to another single standalone non-clustered environment. Clusters are not a requirement for this. And then on the destination, you choose where that replica file will sit. And then finally, you enable the replication for the select virtual machines you want to do. Now, obviously, there is a massive amount of bandwidth that can be consumed of trying to get multiple gigabytes of data out of your network to that destination location. And also ongoing traffic to basically keep them in sync. So you're going to want to selectively choose which ones you enable replication for, and also do some throttling to this, or maybe quality of service to this as well. And so be aware of that before you say, I'm going to take all 30 machines and replicate them to my offsite. Maybe not a good idea. Select the ones you need to have. And also, as you're doing this, you need to also be careful that you have, in a multi-tiered environment, all the pieces you need to have replicated to the other side, obviously, for the Hyper-V replica. And that actually brings me up to able to answer a couple of questions, if you're interested, man. While we're doing that, I'm actually going to go and quickly take a look and
take a look because I'm in the middle of answering another one.
Okay, that's good. That's always good. Here, flip back to my machinist for 1 second, if you could there, Jeff. So this is my failover cluster manager, and I actually configured and have what's known as the replication broker already running because I was trying to do a demo for you guys on this one here. If I want to take a look at this under properties, it simply identifies that this guy is a replication broker, and he's there. I guess I could delete him and bring him back in again if I wanted to. If I go in and take a look specifically on my Hyper-V server settings for this guy here, if you remember, I have the ability to identify how many simultaneous live migrations are allowed from my previous discussion. Also, I have my ability to go through and take a look at my replica configuration. Because this is all grayed out, you can kind of see what I'm talking about here, but basically, because this is on a cluster, it says use the failover cluster manager to configure these settings. Over here, simply, which protocol do I want to use? Certificate-based authentication to prove who I am and who I'm talking to. And then where am I going to be placing my inbound replica data for my system? And then am I going to only allow certain people to replicate into this particular box? You do the same setting on the other side. And then you basically initiate the connection. You initiate the connection by simply saying, here's a individual box, Rex demo. I say replication, enable replication. The wizard kicks off, and unfortunately, the first thing it asks me that prevents me from going through the rest of this wizard is what is the name? What is the name of the destination replication server that I set this up on? I can't put one in here because it basically fails in my demo environment right now. But it would allow me to basically choose how often, which VHDs do I want to replicate, what kind of recovery do I want to have, and then the initial replication method, you actually can choose an exported VM shipped on a hard drive to your destination as your initial source of replication to be able to bring it in on the other side and save you a lot of bandwidth. Like they say, nothing beats bandwidth than a station wagon full of DVDs when you're talking about distances. But you got it, man.
Yeah.
You got it.
Rick, does it do you any good that I'm looking at that machine and it's running and I've got Hyper-V already up and running and I got some VMs running? Anything you can do at this point, or is it too late?
It's too late, because we're going to be wrapping up. One thing I will mention, when you're setting up Hyper-V replica, you must use DNS names or fully qualified domain names as destinations. Mm-hmm. If you try to do a shortcut like I did during the break with IP addresses, it actually will not let you finish off the wizard and use an IP address for that guy there.
You want to explain to them, for those that weren't here yesterday, why I'm wearing a hat?
Why are you wearing a hat?
Well, because
I know why I'm wearing a hat. You actually
look yesterday
good.
Was backup. Today it's just redundancy. Okay. So it's because I want to be like Rick.
You know what? You're waiting for the initial replication.
Yes.
Of the hat to your head, and you just have the placeholder right now. So maybe after the break, we'll be able to have the proper one up there.
We'll see. Hey, real quick, by the way, for anybody who's watching in full screen mode, just wanted you to look for the poll questions that may be out there, and then there'll be some more this afternoon as well.
So basically, you have to drop out of full screen mode to be able to view the webpage again.
Yes. In there.
And we'll go from that. So after the extended break, basically at the top of the hour, we'll be back. And I think we're talking about dynamic access control.
Or is it direct access?
No, dynamic access control. That's the one we were talking about. So we'll see you after the break, top of the hour.